Welcome, everybody. It's wonderful to have you all here on this snowy beginning of winter night. I'm Jenny Misch. I'm the Interim Executive Director of the Sustainable Business Council, and we're delighted to have with us Dave Martin today from Blackfoot Communications. I want to introduce the event first by saying thanks to our sponsors. We have wonderful quesadillas from Taco Sano, and this is the first time that Taco Sano has ever offered quesadillas in a catering kind of environment. So there's a little questionnaire back there. They really wanted to get some feedback to find out if it worked. So if you wouldn't mind filling that out, they would appreciate that. And we also have drinks from Liquid Planet and Big Sky Brewing, so thanks to them for that. And then we have a number of other sponsors that have sponsored our shot series, our sustainability shot series this fall. We've had three events, and this is the third one. So we had support from Family Dental Group and Portico Real Estate, Energetics, Cherry Creek Radio, Sunelco Solar, Missoulian Independent, the Missoula Independent, and of course the Loft here. So we're happy to be here. This is the last event in our fall series, and then next spring we'll have more events coming up, so stay tuned for those. So our fall series of sustainability shots has focused on steps on the sustainability highway, and today we're looking at following the bits on the IT portion of that highway. So our speaker, Dave Martin, is coming from Blackfoot Communications, which, as you all know, the IT can be have a mind of its own, and Dave will help us through that process. Because
remember when I started this conversation.
So Dave actually is an entrepreneur. He founded three companies, two of them in Montana and one of them in California, designing and providing data networking services for Fortune 1000 companies along the West Coast. So he's been a go-getter in his career. He's really got expertise in the evolution of telecommunications, particularly in rural areas. So we've got a nice, you know, sort of perspective on how things have changed during a period of really rapid change. He also spent a few years at Lawrence Livermore Laboratories, where a lot of engineers and scientists, you know, crunch the latest cutting edge things. And he was there developing technologies that support secure communications over fiber in top secret installations. And he was also involved in designing elements of FDDI. Dun, 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 which is fiber distributed data interface networks. And so he joined Blackfoot Communications in 1996, where he championed the conversion of Blackfoot to an all IP communications network, which made Blackfoot one of the first companies in the country to do so. So please help me welcome telecommunications expert Dave Martin from Blackfoot Communications. Oh. And the format for tonight is he'll talk for about 20 minutes and then Q&A. So be thinking about Q&A questions that you have, and he's also interactive. I found out.
Am I? Okay, can I talk really loud?
Yeah.
Okay. So let me first set the stage by saying, you know, if you guys are expecting something serious, reverent, informative, you got to go somewhere else. Because if Sirius is here, I'm over in the parking garage somewhere right now, okay? Then what?
Can you do cartwheels?
I can. Oh, okay. And I don't know about you guys, but when they said the shot series, I was expecting a lineup of little glasses with a... Anyway, so the title, when I sent them the title of the talk, I hadn't yet written the talk. So it's not the same title, and so I figured, you know, everything's got to have an intro slide, right? So this is it, the mandatory intro slide. Oh, and I'm supposed to push buttons to make things go. Okay, so this is what we're going to talk about. Realize that I am a strategist, a technology strategist. I am not a technical expert, okay? So if you guys are going to ask me questions about how to configure something in the little tiny pieces, I know really, really smart people, they're brilliant, that can do those things. I can't, okay? It's a joke around work, by the way. Okay, a little bit about Blackfoot, because it's incumbent upon me to tell you a little bit. We were actually started in 1954 by a group of farmers out in Clinton, right? Phone companies in those days, they didn't have the money to serve sparsely populated areas. So REA, Rural Electrification, funded cooperatives to go ahead and start their own little phone companies. And that's what happened. In fact, one of the founder's grandsons still works in our company, and one of the founder's sons is on our board of directors. By 95, we were serving 22 communities all wrapped around Missoula, from Phillipsburg to Thompson Falls to St. Ignatius, 6,500 square miles, only 14,000 people. Okay. We were the first rural company in America to transition to all IP. What this means is we actually, in 2001, started an initiative. We designed and pushed fiber out really deep into our networks, and we converted all voice communications into IP streams. And so I have a particular hot button when people say VoIP, you send it over the internet. No, VoIP is a protocol. It is does not instantly mean it goes on the internet. We use standard VoIP technologies, but it's all on private networks. And so at any rate, hugely successful. It cut our costs by two-thirds, our annual licensing expenses and stuff. It was an amazing event. We, over the years, have grown. We just this year purchased a couple more companies. We serve all of the major towns in Montana and eastern Idaho now. As you say, 99% of all of them. A non-IT factoid. I hate gardening. This is just me. Okay, I hate it with a passion. However, I really like to do cool stuff with our employee group. So I set aside a square back in our yard for a garden. It took off. The last 2 years, we've donated over 300 pounds to the food bank. And it's good that other people like gardening because it sucks. They die. They die if you don't do stuff with them. I don't understand it. Okay? This is the Blackfoot Network, and it's very quick. These are all 10 gig links. This is a 400 gig link that goes up here. These are all 1 gig links, and these can all be increased any size you want at the turn of a dime. The comments about Missoula not having bandwidth coming to this town are somewhat in error. And we're not the only one. I mean, all of our worthy competitors have just as much bandwidth coming through town. Very, very fat pipes. We're on a major route between Chicago, Minneapolis, and Seattle. So there are just lots of data flowing through there. So on to the stuff that you're here to listen to. So Blackfoot, we have always looked at things from a green perspective, but not because we're benevolent, okay? The bottom line is, save us money. I mean, we've got to run a business. We're a cooperative. Those people invested their hard-earned dollars in us, and we have to return something for it. So when we designed and built our campus, it's up on the north end of Russell Street, very large campus. It takes up a whole city block. The main corporate office, very large, right from the get-go, heated and cooled via ground source heat pumps. We installed about 6 years ago a lighting management system. So it's motion sensors, right? You walk into a room, lights come on. We replaced all of our lighting with fluorescents and or CFLs and thin tube fluorescents. Payback for that whole transition was only 2.5 years, and now we're making money off it. A great thing to undertake, by the way. You can get assistance from the power company. The power company actually provided an engineer to come through and recommend the changes we could make to save dollars. All of our air conditioning systems, cooling and heating, are on timetables, so off hours. It's flipping cold in there, you know. And then when you walk in, you can actually hit a button and it'll turn on the heat for, I think, an hour. But in each zone. But off hours, everything shuts down, and just before people arrive, everything comes back up to speed and heats the place. Same for cooling. Our data center. We have a very nice data center, quite honestly, and it is all cooled through ground source heat pumps. We actually carefully monitor the temperature of the water we're putting back in the ground. We use what's called open loop. So basically, we sunk a couple of big wells. We pump water out, which is cooler, run it through systems inside the building. We have to monitor the temperature, the city, whoever the water gods are, they monitor that and tell us, you know, hey, you're pumping too much heat back in or not or whatever. And so, but it dramatically cuts our cost of cooling the data center. In addition, we use what's called in-row cooling. I know this is horribly exciting for all of you guys. I can tell by So if you think of it, we have these lineups of racks, right? Lots of racks up and down. So you can either cool the whole room, right, to try to keep those things cool, or you can use other methods which are more focused for cooling the equipment. We use one that's called hot aisle, cold aisle, and that technology actually reduced our cooling expense by over 50%. We were using a kind of a general room cooling style, and the technology is advanced enough that we implemented it, and it's been a dramatic savings, and it's far more efficient. I mean, when you walk in there, you open up the cabinets and boom, it's just cold air. But if you walk between the aisles, it's hotter than blue blazes, you know, and so it's very interesting, actually, technology. The cloud. We'll momentarily talk about the cloud, okay? Cloud's an interesting environment. There's tremendous benefit to the cloud. For people like me who are charged with protecting information, our insurance company, we have a cyber insurance company, right? We have a huge cyber insurance policy. When we met with them to negotiate our last one, they brought us all t-shirts that said, "Fear the cloud." Okay? The cloud has tremendous benefits. It also has tremendous risks. Today, 75%, so the last study that I saw from Gartner Group said 75% of all corporate applications in America, 75% are on the cloud. But only 35% of corporations actually have at least one application on the cloud. So you have this strange effect where only 35% of the companies in America have chosen to put applications on the cloud, but those that have, they put a lot of applications there. For somebody like Blackfoot, we have a legal requirement to protect information. There is not a single cloud provider in the United States, and we would never go outside the United States because we'd be subject to foreign laws then as it regards the information out there. There's not a single cloud provider in the United States that will guarantee the protection of your information. If we lose the customer social security number or credit card number, we're liable, not the cloud provider, because we're the service provider connected to the end user. Court battle after court battle has supported that view. So we're very careful. We use a lot of cloud technology, but we also build a lot of cloud technology internally. So they're called private clouds, right? And so, can I work my little machine? Okay, there. We have an internal private cloud. We also provide public cloud services to customers, remote data backup. Everybody who gets an internet connection from us gets a certain amount of storage space, you know. I mean, there's a number of things like that. Over the years, we had all of these racks of standalone computers running all of our software, right, internal and external software. So in 2006, we converted to what are called blade servers. Instead of having racks of computers sitting, you know, like that, right, we have one chassis, and we have just basically plug-in cards, and each card is actually a server, right? Now that we even have cards that are two or four servers. And so that helped. But the big step was in 2009, we finally completed the implementation of what's called a virtual server environment. And so in software, we create virtual servers. And we assign multiple virtual servers to these blade servers. Okay, it's kind of esoteric if you're not actually interested in that kind of stuff. At the end of the day, what it means is that a given server is only in the ether. It has no permanent home, and it's only assigned a permanent home when it needs to be used. The biggest thing for us, 80% reduction in power consumption. Massive. We went from 50 actual hard servers, like think of computers stacking in a rack, right? 50 of them, over 50 actually, to 40 virtual servers on 7 blades. That's just 7 little plug-in cards replaced racks and racks of these big servers. And we actually have more performance capability out of this. We can also, if somebody needs a server, we can go in and in 30 minutes actually turn up a new server. because it's just virtual. It doesn't really exist anyplace. Kind of. Okay. The change to IP switching. It was interesting. Our power consumption, when we changed, we dropped from 800 square feet of floor space to 36 square feet. The power consumption in our main office here went from 156 kilowatt hours to 15 kilowatt hours per day, a 90% decrease. Understand, we also have 22 remote buildings, Thompson Falls, St. Ignatius, all of these far-flung places, right? Each one of them had standard old big switching boxes. Those were also converted, literally, to maybe a half a rack, right? And so, this is what the old world looked like. These green things, those are the ends of what we call lineups. We had 15 of them in Missoula that were 27 feet long. That's me when I had hair and was taller, okay? So that was our world, and that was every telco's world. Huge producers of heat, huge power consumers. That is now what replaced it, and this has twice the capacity of all of those other great big cabinets, right? And out in our remote places, as I said, we have less than a half a rack in each one of those remote buildings. Whereas before, they had probably two of those lineups of those huge cabinets. A huge decrease in cost of cooling, cost of electrical consumption, cost of licensing. This is actually, I just threw it in here because I really like it. So this is just a portion of our data center. These are really cool looking, if you like really cool, sleek looking black racks and stuff. That's very cool. And this is these big old pipes right here. They feed all of our, that hot aisle, cold aisle cooling system. This is the end of a lineup that actually drives the cooling air through it. So our whole data center is piped with all of those big black pipes overhead. And anywhere we want to drop cabinets or rows of cabinets, we just tap into those big old pipes and drop that cooling capability in there. I think it's cool, and after all, I am giving the presentation. Okay, so what are we doing as we move forward? Some of this we're already doing, some of it's future-focused. I screwed up on the title, so don't pay attention. It's multifaceted, right? Five syllables all at once. So we do continue to promote and use green services or green efforts within our company. We have for many, many years recycled paper, right? We recycle plastic and aluminum. Everywhere you go on our campus, we have bins that are totally separated for it. We do consider supply chain characteristics. We are a cooperative, thankfully, very focused on getting content from North America, right? Making sure that to the extent we can, everything we buy is has a level of greenness. God, I can't think of a good term for it. Okay, so we recycle like crazy. Actually, 5 years ago, we had a program where we tried to recycle dry cell batteries. You know, single A, double A, triple A, C, D, and whatever other little word that might be up there. It was a resounding failure, right? We had little buckets all over the place. To this day, they still are sitting there. Not a single one of them has ever been filled. You're fighting human nature. There's a certain thing. Most of the dry cells are used by our technicians out in the field. So for them to say, whenever they switch out, put them somewhere in the truck, and then when they come in, go find a bucket, and then go ahead and put it in there. That was issue number one. Number two was finding some place that would actually recycle. We have to ship these to Minnesota, right? Huge trucking expenses. The batteries are heavy. And so at the end of the day, it just failed. And as I say, the buckets are still there. We will continue to consolidate. We'll continue to outsource services like software as a service, where we actually go to some big provider in the sky, you know, and use their service. It's more energy efficient because these guys scale up really big. So on a per computing cycle, they can do it cheaper than we can. So where they don't have to house secure data, we absolutely continue down that path and use them as much as possible, and we'll continue to do so. Where secure data has to leave the premises, now the guy in charge of that says no. So that'd be me. We'll continue virtualization. And so one aspect we're really looking into, there was a big flurry a while ago about desktop virtualization, meaning that basically your whatever device you have, you log in and your whole profile appears on the device, whether you're at a desktop or wherever. I love it. I want it to happen. It's just not ready for us yet. The costs are very high. There's when we get to that point, then we can divorce ourselves from having to so tightly control the devices people use. We have to do that for security. You know, there's some devices I just can't allow on campus because I can't guarantee the security of the information they use because it resides on their device. Once we get to virtualization, they come on campus, they log in, they work through a browser, and they're doing their job, doing whatever, and when they shut off that device, there's none of that information on their device. It's still sitting back in our virtual servers, all of those servers that exist in the ether. So at any rate, PowerPoint, this is a particular thing for me. I know PowerPoint, people, you know, complain about, geez, PowerPoint, then PowerPoint. Fact of the matter is, I really hate walking into meetings and seeing people having printed out reams of paper. Either they're printed out the presentation, which really drives me crazy, or they have printed out documentation. Instead, what we really want to do is portable communications environments. Make sure everybody has a tablet. I'm not a big Apple fan, but that's another story. But there's plenty of tablets out there that, you know, that are convenient, notebooks, things like that, so that the material they're working with is ever present on an electronic device instead of printing out pages and pages and pages of information to haul into a meeting. Bring your device into the meeting. Sit down, relax, have a beer. Well, wait. Okay, so here's some more things that we use at Blackfoot. We actually have GP-enabled routing of all of our vehicles. So we have a system that knows where all of our vehicles are and looks at what work has to be done. And then between both taking advantage of time and fuel consumption, we can route the right people to the right place at the right time. Works really well. We have reporting systems that report our energy use, you know, and so, and IT services can continue to expand on that. We use smart boards like crazy. We have offices in Idaho and Bozeman and Missoula. We have smart boards in all those environments. The engineers, it looks like Minority Report. They get on that board and their arms are flying and things are shooting to the corners and there's stuff expanding and contracting, and it makes me seasick. So here's some other stuff that I just like, okay, because I threw it in because I figured the whole first two-thirds of it was boring as a dickens. So here's the rest of it. Self-piloting cars. Huge fuel savings are projected, right? Believe it or not, Nevada, Florida, California have passed legislation to allow self-piloting cars in test mode on the highways. They're expecting actually to be able to sell vehicles by 2020. Yeah, we've expected a lot of things. We'll see. I like it. So anyway, you can see the fuel savings are tremendous. Hot data centers, maybe to most of you guys this isn't a big deal, but this is so cool to me. They literally, Dell and Microsoft got together and did some pilot programs where they moved cargo containers out there, out behind some building. They stuffed it full of servers, no active cooling. They literally drilled holes, you know, low against the ground on one side, high against the ground on the other, and then ran the system for months. They the average temperature hit 104. But none of the equipment ever failed because modern manufacturing techniques now allows this equipment to run really hot. I do question about technicians having to go in there. I hate to see a bunch of technicians running in there in bikini briefs. But at any rate, you know, it's a great smart homes. Obviously, you guys hear lots about that. We've heard lots about it for many, many years. We're starting to see traction. Actually, people starting to use it. It's less expensive. It's more easy to configure by a home user. It's more dynamic, more interactive. And so controlling virtually anything, smart water is very cool. It reduces water consumption. I can't remember the brand, so I wrote smart water to remind myself. So it actually controls the output of the water, but it shapes the water drops so that sensation on your skin feels like you're actually having a very high flow of water, but it reduces the water flow by over 30%. It was very cool, I thought. But I'm easily impressed. Smart grid. This is managing the power grid. It's a big, big deal. It saves billions and billions of dollars. It's been a long time coming. Blackfoot, actually, 6 years ago, was the only telephone company that was a member of a National Association for Smart Grid Technology. And it was because we were very interested in actually running broadband over the electrical systems. It's phenomenal what they can do. Now, only 10% of the grid environment is two-way, meaning you can communicate, your home can communicate back to the electrical grid, but 75% of the grid can communicate down to devices. So what that means is that the smart grid can actually communicate to your home and say, we're seeing too much load, we're going to lower your energy use by actually going in, say, and cycling your refrigerator on and off, okay? Or we're going to go in and we're going to perhaps lower the amount of power we send to your hot water heater. This is future stuff we're talking about, but this is a completely, you're going to see a thing up here that I'm going to briefly talk. I don't briefly talk very well, guys. I'm sorry about this. But we'll talk about the Internet of Things. It's fascinating, scary, and fascinating. Remote medical center services, I just got done doing at a presentation down in Idaho, and a large component of it was talking about remote medical services, connecting people in rural America to advanced medical services. Folks, there's a vest that some folks can wear, and it sends all of the vitals, blood pressure, everything remotely. Remote diagnostics. There's another company that, I don't know if it's there, no. There's a company that makes a little puck that plugs into a smartphone. It'll do, measure your heart rate, your blood pressure, your blood alcohol. Well, it'll measure that too. but your oxygen saturation in your blood, it'll perform urinalysis, and it'll rate your liver functions. And so that's where the alcohol thing came in. But anyway, it costs $150, and it plugs into your smartphone. You know, that technology has taken off so quickly, it is absolutely amazing. And it's based on the need to serve a wider range of folks, elderly who can't move around very, very well, rural America, very sparse, and the ability to provide very high quality care to remote clinics through telecommuting or video conferencing, remote hands, doing operations on people from 300 miles away, you know, all of those technologies are fascinating, just fascinating. Ta-da! The Internet of Things. Look it up, just look it up. This is something that I've been to a couple of conferences on, and it's a Cisco invention as far as the term goes, but it's a very real, frightening and exciting kind of future. When you think about it, think about RFID chips. Little tiny things, they look like a flake of pepper, right? In manufacturing, they embed these in clothing, in shipping and stuff. So they can track inventory through shipping. They can route stuff automatically, right? The Internet of Things is a concept that says, look, IPv6, it's a new way to create IP addresses for things. The new way says that we have so many IP addresses available that we could address every single thing in the world, right, and never run out. What that says is that every single thing can have a unique address. And because these little RFID chips and other small components can be, they're so tiny, they're like smaller than a grain of sand, they can be embedded in everything. So imagine walking down the street, okay? The street knows who you are. It knows it from your smartphone. It knows it from an RFID chip that's embedded in the shirt that you bought with your credit card, and it was that shirt was identified to you as that purchaser. The people who are monitoring your buying habits know that you bought that shirt and you frequent this street. And that billboard over there, as you pass by, is going to come up with an advertisement that is tailored to catch your attention. And as you move through your environment, you walk into the store, you walk down the aisles, right? They know your buying habits. Hey, I know that you like Fido fresh food for your cat or something like that, you know? And so a light, it slowly highlights that bit of food in the shopping area. You move on out through and further down the street. You go into a restaurant, right? Oh, by the way, it knows that, you know, your favorite kind of music, because we see you on Spotify all the time, is X. To improve your mood when you're in there, we might go ahead and just slowly fade in some music that you really like. You move into your house. So all of this, it sounds sci-fi-ish, but believe me, this is stuff that is emerging. People don't realize, you know, you think about the fiber to the home, that project that Google is doing, and people think, oh, that'd be so cool to have it and everything. And it's true. However, how do you think Google funds that? They don't care how much they sell it for. They fund it because today Google is a massively successful company because they sell all of your habits, surfing habits. But today they can only sell the information about what you do whenever you're using a Google service. If you do a Google search, if you use Gmail, right, then they know what your patterns are. But what happens if they have fiber to your house and everything you do on the internet is now tracked through Google? Okay? They now know everything you do on the internet. And this is not nefarious. I'm not trying to paint a picture of, oh, you know. What I'm saying is that information is hugely valuable. And so it just increases their ability to understand your habits and then more ably target basically marketing towards you. So anyway, interesting concepts. Look up Internet of Things. It's just so fascinating. I mean, the future of what'll happen when you're just walking around and the world adapts to who you are and what you want and what you normally do. It's just, as I say, frightening and fascinating. Yeah, okay. Okay, so these are the last eight things, okay? What to do when you get going, when you want to try to do this. First, set realistic goals. Too many people try to overachieve too quickly. Assign a champion. You have to have somebody that's going to carry the water at all times and not give up. If you don't, plan. Yeah, you know, that's part of getting it done. Prepare. Audit your systems, like, you know, figure out how much am I spending on lights, how much am I spending on water, how much am I, you know, know what your baseline is before you get started so you can measure the gains and verify. Be open-minded. Ideas come from the strangest places. I have a story to tell about Spain and an idea, but I'm not going to. Budget. You got to have a realistic budget. This stuff costs money. And another important part is, where's my fancy little pointer? I love it. Right here. If you've got a small operation, you may not save enough money to offset the cost of implementing some of this stuff. That's a reality. So is dollar saved the only measure of success? That's a question you have to ask yourself. If it is better for the planet, better for the community, better for your employees, and it costs you a little more, is it still a good thing to do? That's a question that only you can answer. Publicly celebrate the wins. Get out there and tell people, Facebook, Twitter, you know, whatever, hey, our company did this and it was so cool, it was wonderful, you know. It actually increases basically the public's good feeling about your company and what you're attempting to do. And most importantly, this is really critical to me, have fun. It's a great world and enjoy it, you know. That's all I have to say.
Thank you,
Dave. Oh, and I have.
Clearly Dave knows how to have fun. And yeah. He touched on a number of topics that you all have questions about. He covered a lot of terrain. Some of it futuristic and practical and detailed, so no question is too small to go forward. Who would like to pose a question? Kara.
Yes. So I don't know how fast IT stuff new stuff keeps on coming out, but when you made that switch over to the smaller servers, was that kind of an iffy point for you to wait out for newer technology to wait?
No, you know, actually we planned it out for a while. And it was a matter of, we can keep buying box after box after box, or we can just go ahead and make the leap now. And the cards themselves, the virtualization, if that's where you're going, it is more future-proofed at a lower cost than replacing 50 individual hardware servers on a 3-year cycle. So I can upgrade software, or replace a blade if I have to, a lot less expense.
Okay.
You get one of these things.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Colin.
Thanks for your presentation. I was curious with the private clouds, is it like a hard drive connected to your computer? Can you only access it from one IP address?
No.
And if not, how is it private?
It's private because it's only accessible over a private network. Okay? So Blackfoot has a private network that extends from Missoula to Bozeman to Idaho. It's completely private. Our traffic does not run over the internet. They're dedicated circuits that connect those properties. And so we have virtual servers on Blade architecture, and so that is the cloud environment. If you think about a cloud environment, that it's a ton of virtualization, but cloud comes in three varieties: private, public, and hybrid. Okay, and private is just, it's the same kind of technology, but it's only accessible over private network connections rather than public.
You can only access it from Blackfoot.
Yes,
services. Okay.
From Blackfoot network. Yeah. So it could be any one of our 200 computers, desktop computers, right? Anywhere on our network. Just not over the internet. Oh.
So I think one of the most inspiring parts about having a business that's sustainable is like an educational facet. With Blackfoot Communications, you have such a far reach. Can you think of any ways to incentivize like wise energy use or efficiency for your customers?
Yeah. You know, I think that's a great question. And I'm stumbling because I'm thinking, see, what we focus on when we think of education of our customers is wise use of communications. There's a tangential effect to say, look, and I didn't touch on this and I apologize, that use video conferencing instead of getting in the car. Use all of those remote technologies to connect you to the office. I mean, today they can take their business phone, if it's an IP phone, home and work from home perfectly fine. From that perspective, that education does happen frequently. When it comes to direct energy use policy, or we look to people like Missoula Electric Co-op, who we have a very strong affiliation with. In fact, they're the ones who came in, as I said, and engineered our energy improvement plan.
I'm sure there are other questions. One of the questions I had was to ask you to talk a little bit more about cooperatives. You just mentioned Missoula Electric Co-op.
Sure.
How the cooperative business model operates, because there's some sustainability components of that, and in particular, you know, how you've benefited from being a cooperative.
So the way the cooperative, at least our cooperative, works is, as I said, it started off with a bunch of farmers in Clinton, right? And so every customer of Blackfoot in the rural territories, this is not our competitive business enterprises in the rest of Montana and Idaho. This is our original 22 rural communities, right? Every person who buys service, a percentage of the cost of that service, a percentage of the bill they pay actually becomes an investment in the company. They actually earn, they develop, if you will, shares within our company. They get dividend checks most years based on those shares. And so they have voting rights. They elect a board of directors to basically oversee Blackfoot in our strategic plans and directions. We have a very close relationship with our board of directors, as does our customer base. They're the go-between between us all.
So not all customers are owner members of the cooperative, just in those 22 counties?
Just in those 22 communities. Because the cooperative charter is very restricted to those rural environments, those 22 rural environments. In the business environment, that's a very, very competitive environment. And honestly, the reason we even go into that environment, that we do all these other things, the rural environment is very expensive to deploy telephone services. As you can imagine, we cover 6,500 square miles, 14,000 users, okay? I mean, in Seattle, they get 14,000 users in six square blocks. So the you know, much less expensive environment. So we go out and do for-profit work to feed that money back into the cooperative to offset the normal increased cost of doing business in the cooperative. So we can keep their rates at least close to what people in larger areas provide. There's other elements, there's some government funding, things like that, but that continues to dry up, so we continue to be more aggressive.
That's an illustration of the social component of sustainability in the triple bottom line, as well as the environmental. So Blackfoot Communications is fully owned by the cooperative, or is it a separate corporation?
No. So the cooperative owns a holding company, and the holding company owns all of the for-profit companies below it.
Thank you.
You're welcome, and you get one of these too.
Question. I enjoyed your presentation.
Oh, thanks.
I was wondering, it seemed like Blackfoot was so innovative, visionary, and even maybe courageous to implement all these changes, because usually everybody wants the status quo, like big established. Like, was it all just really cut and dry, obvious, oh, we just got to do this, or was there any kind of hurdles to it? And how did you guys do it?
You know, remember the one thing up here was having a champion? So I'm a very strong believer in vision. You establish vision. That actually is what I do. I'm a strategic guy. I establish strategic vision or work towards that with a bunch of people. And so Blackfoot actually entered the mobile wireless business in 96. And then we actually deployed a fixed wireless broadband service in 97. You know, I mean, what happened was the government has provided subsidies for rural America, but the government has been flip-flopping about how long they'll be sustained, yada, yada. We saw quite a while ago that, A, we need to cut costs, we need to provide advanced services, and we need to figure out cheaper ways to do business. So we need to, you know, go far astray from where the rest. There's 1,200 rural telephone companies in America. I guarantee you, we go to conferences and it's a constant, we are still way outside of the norm for those folks. We actually, when we deployed IP in our switching and our distribution network, we actually had to work with the equipment manufacturers to design the equipment to be able to provide that, because they were only using the equipment for very large companies that were transporting calls overseas. They had never really dealt in, you know, the just North American rural kind of telephony. And so it was a matter of saying, look, we know these are the things and if we truly believe in our heart that these are the right things to do, we need to create a vision statement, we need to put it out there, and we need to just drive, you know, it's the North Star, the guiding star, we need to go there. It's not that the vision can't be modified with good reason, but there's got to be something that you drive toward. And I'm a very, very firm believer in that. And so, long-winded way of answering your question.
Great presentation.
Thanks.
I was wondering about the virtualization that what were all the costs that actually what were all the costs that were actually reduced by virtualizing?
So the costs were power consumption and hardware. Okay. Because if you think about between 40 and 50 servers, okay? Our servers run $7,000 to $10,000 a piece, all right? So you're looking at $500,000. Well, our Blade servers, I think, ran around $40,000, $45,000 for the shelf with the servers. And then our virtualization software, we're well below $100,000 for the whole system. Plus, as I say, we've reduced power consumption, and on a going forward basis, we can easily spin up virtual servers within minutes almost. And so, yeah, there, that's what I have to say.
Also, sorry, one more thing.
We had a lot of feedback last time, that's why I'm trying to keep
you. Yeah. what is the trend kind of going towards that for the rest of the companies in your industry? Is that really been a full takeover, or are a lot of companies still trying to jump on board or really trying to hold back?
On as far as
going really towards virtualization?
It's a clear path that's the right direction. You know, there's we have a wide range. Let's say there's 1,200 phone companies, 1,200 rural companies in the United States. There's another dozen or so large companies, right? So it's dependent on the size and skill sets within that company. The vast majority of rural telephone companies aren't moving in this direction because they don't have the skill sets internal. And to drive, and they have things that they're more worried about. And there's a subset, you know, there's probably, out of 1,200, there's maybe 100 of us that are in a completely different zone, if you will, you know, that have moved down that road. They will all have to go there because at some point in time, it will become ridiculously expensive to do anything else. But that could be 10 years from now, quite honestly. Depends on what services they're trying to offer also. Is it driving them to deploy a lot more servers? Or is their status quo just fine and they'll just run it until things rust and fall off the shelf?
I really appreciate the efforts that you've made to reduce your energy consumption. But the view that you've presented today is using a lot of technology mm-hmm. to drive this. And while I realize there are challenges in integrating low-tech solutions too, such as daylighting and passive heating and cooling, have you had any success or tried to integrate these two modes?
Yeah, you know, our buildings were built bluntly several years ago. And so the short answer is yes, a little bit. If you look at our main campus building, on the south side, there's a big greenhouse. And that was specifically designed to improve heating in the winter months. Or, you know, So to the extent we could as they were constructed and to the extent we could within reasonable amount retrofit, yes. But certainly not, if we were building a new building today, it'd be entirely a different game. So... that's where we are.
Thank you.
You got to be fast. No. I'm going to put somebody's eye out. I know I'm going to get sued.
Hey, Dave, really great presentation.
Hey, thanks, Tom.
One of the questions I have is, do you have any tips? I think measurement is always a difficult process when you're doing this. Like how measuring the gains that you've made over the past 5 or 10 years.
Yeah.
Do you have any tips on how maybe in your experience you guys did some measurement of that or maybe best practices?
Yeah, you know, it's critical to, you're just right. So go and so for instance, for us in the power systems that feed our servers, we actually meter the power consumption of the inline servers, right? Not everybody is going to be able to do that bluntly. It depends. I mean, if you've got two racks of servers, are you really going to spend $1,500 to get an inline metering system? So then what you need to do instead is carefully meter at the most discrete point. You can actually meter at a panel for not too much money, right? So set up those kinds of measurement points. And then as you move forward, you know, you can see what changes are occurring. After you implement changes, honestly, Tom, that's all I got, man. That's you know, it's based on its power consumption. That's the big driver for us is in from that perspective. Obviously, the dollars associated with different technology architectures, right? Those are easily measurable. But you're right, the power consumption is difficult.
Now, measurement is really always a challenge with sustainability, particularly when you get into the intangible things, mm-hmm. so like some of your more social benefits and so forth. So it's always tricky. Another question here.
Yeah. One more question for you. So
you're broke.
I have more. Are you afraid now?
So right now it seems like a lot of companies are moving in the direction. There's a lot of research that shows, you know, a lot of the things you're doing actually ends up being more profitable, like you said.
Mm-hmm.
But when you guys started back in 96, as a member-owned cooperative, how did you convince the member owners to do this at a time when it wasn't being done?
So the way the cooperative works is the cooperative members are represented by a board of directors. We actually, for good or bad, don't have to convince the members. We have to convince the board of directors. And we do that by doing our homework, quite bluntly. I mean, you know, we don't do things, we're an analytical company. We actually have two economic analysts on in our company. And so we're very analytical. And when we go through these efforts, we say, look, here's what happens if we do it. Here's what happens if we don't. And in some case, it is swimming uphill. You're absolutely right. A great example is America was in love with fiber to the home, okay? I know people still are. But in rural America, overbuilding and putting fiber, what we like to call fiber to the barn, was very popular because rural telephone companies get funded by the government for their deployment of equipment and cable in the ground. The fact of the matter is, if I put fiber into your house, are you all of a sudden going to pay me five times as much as you were for your internet service? No, right? But it cost me that much to put that fiber in there when I had perfectly good copper delivering 15 mega service to your house. And so that was an uphill battle for us because every conference that our board of directors went to, they were pitching fiber to the home, fiber to the home. Get those federal dollars, your people will love you, you know. We were looking down the road and saying, what happens when that subsidy goes the way? We're going to be stuck with these huge loans of tens and hundreds of millions of dollars. And so it's a relationship with the board of directors to convince them that what we're doing is smart and future-proof and taking us to, you know, a really solid direction. I think you got one already, right? Okay, good.
I might be too close to the speaker, so if I get feedback, I apologize. So I was kind of curious, you mentioned that you guys have your own cloud, basically a private cloud.
Yes.
And I think you said that businesses could actually contract with you to use your cloud.
No.
No. Okay. So it's just for your original use.
We will build private cloud
for
a company. We have public cloud services that we do sell to customers. Our private cloud is strictly ours and doesn't connect to the outside world in any fashion.
So are you then using some national entity to do the public cloud? Or
we actually have two grades of service, if you will. One is a commodity grade, and we do white label, it's called. We resell a national cloud provider service. The other is a higher grade storage service for a little bigger companies. And we actually have our own public cloud that we have at our data center for those folks.
So you're really talking about, so to get the security of that you're saying that you provide, it's pretty much the large entities that would use your public cloud versus the smaller folks who are going to be on the white label?
No. Any public cloud service is exposed, okay? So we make no guarantees, just as no one else does, in the security of your data. We do our best. Believe me, we're not sitting there saying, hey, come on in, steal everything you want. No, we don't do that. But we won't guarantee that because honestly, I mean, I saw a great presentation at the university just about 4 months ago. One of the foremost international security experts was talking about the difficulty of keeping up with viruses and hacking attacks and stuff. Somebody in the audience asked him, said, aren't you one of the foremost authorities in the world? Yes, I am. And a great guy. And they said, well, so you're telling me they're smarter than you? And he goes, I'll tell you what. I work 10 hours a day, 6 days a week. When I'm done working, I go home, I play with my kids, I take my wife out to dinner, I might go golfing on the weekend. That hacker that's trying to break into our system is working 24 hours a day in a little dark corner in Uzbekistan, you know, and he's liable to make up to $100,000 for one successful virus. That's his whole world. He has an advantage, and I'm not willing to, you know. So it's a very interesting perspective. So at any rate, that's why companies can't guarantee the sanctity of data. So if it's data you're worried about ever losing control of, don't put it on the public cloud. And I'm not an anti-cloud guy. Believe me, I'm not. I am very pro-cloud. Pro-cloud? That's a cool word to even say. Say it. Pro-cloud. I'm going to pro-cloud that I like that word. And no, this is all I've had, right? I'd throw this to you, but could you catch it?
No,
okay.
Do we have time for one more question? Okay. Is there another question? Yes.
Like, it seems like I work for PG&E, and they were downsizing like every quarter over the several years just to make their quarterly stock prices go up. And, you know, we look at the government, a lot of common sense has just fallen by the wayside. How come you guys have it? Why are you, like, what, how do you guys maintain your common sense?
Lordy. You know, we have great folks in our company. We do have a clear vision, and we work hard to get the employees to buy into the vision. We all try to buy into it. I'm not going to josh you, but you know, not all employees, as you would expect in any group of people. There's a range of, you know, stars, middle, and would rather be somewhere. And so, and we have that in our company. It's like any company. We pay very well. We provide a really solid work environment. We promote a lot of healthy things. We have a health committee. We have, you know, you can earn points and win jackets and all kinds of stuff for the number of miles you walk and all those kinds of things that go on in our company. At the end of the day, too, though, we owe our cooperative owners a lot. We owe them our existence. We owe our customers our existence. That's the mantra in our company, our cooperative owners and our customers. And so the things we do, while some people look at them as, you know, advanced and cutting edge, they're things that we make decisions on to make sure, A, we're still here another 50 years from now, providing very leading edge services to a rural community that normally wouldn't have access to it. Those people out there today, they can get you know, unified messaging. They get their voicemails on their email account. I mean, they're sitting up here in Heron, you know, and getting these kinds of services. And so there's a large faction of our company, of our employees, that buy into that desire, that vision of, you know, being that kind of provider. And we have the same philosophy when it goes to providing business services to businesses. We actually are not the lowest priced people around, you know, but we have a fantastic group of people that really believe in this, and they, you know, and so it's kept everybody healthy and happy, and it's good.
Well, thank you so much, Dave. I'd like to offer you a 100% organic tote bag with the SBC logo on it. Let's say thank you for
so
being with
us
tonight.
If I leave it outside too long, will it just like disintegrate into
eventually
the soil?
Will disintegrate
okay.
Into the soil. I'm sure it's completely, you know, disintegratable, biodegradable. It was wonderful to have you with us.
Thank
good.
Thank
you very much.
Thanks. Thank you. And never despair. I have enough for everybody. So people who want a thumb drive, feel free.
So although this is our last sustainability shot of this season, and I would like to say that the Sustainable Business Council raised the bar in the deal when we were founded in 2002 by putting sustainability and business on the map and creating a discussion about it. We've had over 50 events, educational events through the years, and on very particular topics of interest to businesses and organizations around sustainability. We also raised the bar in 2008 when we launched a Buy Local program for the first time in Missoula, and now there's lots of other organizations promoting local purchasing for lots of good reasons. And we don't have any more educational events until next year, but stay tuned for those. But we do have a Buy Local program that is just launching this week, so you'll be seeing our ads in the newspapers and hearing them on the radio, and we have a contest so that you can go to three merchants and snap a photo of the QR code or take the phrase and plug it into a website, and we'll have three monthly drawings. So please shop local for your holiday gift needs. And we also are going to have a First Friday event on December 6th to launch our new website, which is a really exciting upgrade for our members, because now, from now on, our members will be able to post their own content and promotions on their own webpage on our website. So we're really excited about that. So as the holiday season comes up, we're going to be moving into having quarterly Buy Local programs. So we'll be looking at the building industries in the spring, and services and food in summer and fall. So we've got lots of exciting things coming. So stay tuned. If you're not on our mailing, on our newsletter list, sign up, like us on Facebook, and stay tuned, because we've got some big changes and exciting things coming up. So thanks again to Dave and to all of you for coming.